Okay, hello everyone. Good morning. Today we'll be talking about hepatotoxicity. Right? Hepatotoxicity is something that we've been discussing in the class for a pretty long time, not as a topic, but as something that comes with individual drugs. Right? Whenever we talked about different drugs, we did talk about hepatotoxicity. You might as well remember when we talked about NSAIDs, then we did talk about hepatotoxicity, right? About NS, and then even the anti-tubercular drugs. When we talked about anti-tubercular drugs, we talked about hepatotoxicity. So hepatotoxicity comes times and again when we go on talking about different kinds of drugs. In that, there are more than 1,000 drugs and different chemicals that are known to be hepatotoxic. So hepatotoxicity is something we've been talking for a long, long time, right? So let us look into the contents that we'll be talking about today. We'll be talking about the introduction of hepatotoxicity. Then we'll be talking about the injury types as to which one is predictable. If something is directly hepatotoxic, chemical is there, is involved, then it's predictable. And if a chemical is not directly causing hepatotoxicity or causes hepatotoxicity by immune mechanisms, then we call it unpredictable kind of hepatotoxicity, right? Then we'll be talking about the various risk factors for susceptibility to DELI. Here, DELI refers to drug-induced liver injury or hepatotoxicity itself. Then we'll be talking about the various examples like Reed syndrome, alcoholic liver disease, prevention, severity, management, treatment, and conclusion. The chart on the right, which lists the various drugs, right? This is taken from a 2019 study that was conducted in Nepal and which lists the hepatotoxic drug that they found out in their study. The first is anti-tubercular drugs, then paracetamol, then other NSAIDs, anti-seizure drugs, anti-leprosy drugs, atorvastatin, warfarin, and methotrexate. Okay, when you look at the figure out here, what you can see is that drug, normally, either the drug or its metabolite, they are known to be hepatotoxic, and then they cause hepatotoxicity as a result of various mechanisms like cholestasis to mitochondrial dysfunction, chemical stress, drug bioactivation, covalent bonding, binding, apoptosis, hepatocyte hypertrophy, hepatocyte hyperplasia, hepatocyte necrosis, fibrosis, activation of the innate immune system, and activation of adaptive immune system. Okay, now moving on to introduction. The term hepatotoxicity, it implies the chemical-driven liver damage, or we could also call it drug-induced liver injury or DELI insert, right? Some chemicals, they are known to be coherently hepatotoxic. They can either be directly hepatotoxic or their metabolites can be hepatotoxic. And liver is generally the major site for drug toxicity. Why so? Because it is the major site of drug metabolism, right? And cytochrome P450 is located in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum of the liver, and it is either induced or inhibited by drugs. So also it's implicated in hepatotoxicity. The liver is highly susceptible to drug-induced injury because of its high metabolic capacity. Basically, when we talked about metabolism, we did talk about the phase 1 and phase 2 reactions, right? When we talked about metabolism, we said that phase 1 and phase 2 reactions are happen normally. Phase 1 reaction, it goes for functionalization reaction, and phase 2 reaction, it goes for conjugation reaction. But then there is also a kind of reaction that is called phase 3 reaction. And phase 3 reaction is linked with xenobiotics concentration in the liver through various transport mechanisms like anion, organic anion transporter, and organic cation transporter. The liver toxicity of most of the drugs seem to be mediated by adaptive immune response with or without products of drug-specific antibodies. Okay. With hepatotoxicity, it is seen that almost 1,000 drugs, toxins, and herbs, they are known to be hepatotoxic. Drug hepatotoxic is the leading cause of acute liver failure, and approximately 50% of all the cases of liver failure that happens in the US, that is around 1,000 cases of acute liver failure, it is known to be due to drug-induced hepatotoxicity. Now, drug-induced acute liver failure is associated with high morbidity and high mortality. And there's only 20% survival chance in absence of liver transplantation. The drug-induced hepatic injury is more common reason cited for withdrawal of an approved drug. And if we look into the more data of hepatotoxicity in the US, because we don't have so much data on the hepatotoxicity, right? So if you look into the US data on hepatotoxicity, we see that approximately 2,000 cases of acute liver failure occur annually, and drugs account for over 50% of them. That is almost 1,000 cases are due to drugs. And of the 1,000 cases of hepatotoxicity seen in the US, 39% of them are due to acetaminophen or paracetamol, and 13% are idiosyncratic reactions that occur due to other medications. If you look at the case, you see that 39% of 1,000 cases, that is 390 cases of acute liver failure occurring as a result of acetaminophen or paracetamol, it seems that paracetamol is a relatively toxic drug, right? It is not that paracetamol is very, very toxic, but then paracetamol is often highly used, being an OTC drug, it is highly used as an analgesic drug, right? And again, the problem is with paracetamol comes as fixed dose combination drug in various combinations, like paracetamol comes in cough and cold medicines, right? Rynex, Cynex, if you think about the cold medications, then paracetamol is still there. So what do people do? If they have some kind of fever, then people take paracetamol normally for lowering the body temperature, and then they again go to use Cynex and Rynex as cough and cold medication, right? Or for flu. So the chances are that you are taking paracetamol from different sources at the same time, and this can lead to hepatotoxicity. Typically, if the person is susceptible to the hepatotoxicity caused by acetaminophen. Acetaminophen causes hepatotoxicity if the person is fasting, especially, and if the person is old or too young. Okay, in case of small babies and elderly people, fragile people, and in case of fasting people, because of glutathione depletion, the agent which is necessary for conjugation of acetaminophen and excreting it finally. Drugs account for 2 to 5% of patients hospitalized with jaundice and approximately 10% of all the cases of acute hepatitis. The US FDA has withdrawn different drugs from the market at several times as a result of severe liver injury. Bromfenac is the drug that was introduced in 1997 and 1998, and it had more than 50 cases of severe hepatic damage, following which it was taken off the market. But then later on, it was again used as eye drop only following cataract surgery. While using as an eye drop, it does not go into systemic circulation, so there is not much of a trouble, so it is still used now. Similarly, troglitazone is another drug, quite like pioglitazone and rosiglitazone, and it was also taken off from the market because of more than 90 cases of severe hepatotoxicity. So all the drugs that reach phase 4 levels of clinical trial, right, post-marketing surveillance of the phase 4 trials, they may be taken off the market as a result of hepatotoxicity. We can find the information of documented hepatotoxicity of drugs at LiverTox. LiverTox is a subsite of NLM and NIH. So you can go to this website and find out details about different hepatotoxic drugs, right? According to critical analysis of hepatotoxicity of drugs that is shown in LiverTox, it is seen that 53% of the drugs had at least one case report of convincing reports of hepatotoxicity. And only 48 drugs or more had more than 50 cases of drug-induced liver injury, of which amoxicillin clavulanate is the most commonly indicated agent leading to drug-induced hepatotoxicity in the prospective studies. Other drugs with highest risk being azathioprine, infliximab, okay? And these are the list of drugs with more than 100 cases of hepatotoxicity. You can have a look. This is a long, long list. Have a look. Okay, so you are not expected to remember each and every drug in the list, right? But then you at least try and remember something. Now, by the end of the class, you'll be remembering at least 5 to 10 drugs, I believe, right? So let us move forward. When it comes to drug-induced liver injury, they are either classified as unpredictable or predictable, right? Unpredictable is when it is not dose-related, and it's very rare. It occurs weeks to months after ingestion of the drug, and it is basically as a result of idiosyncratic reaction to the drug. immune-mediated idiosyncrasy or hypersensitivity is involved. So there is rash, fever, arthralgia, eosinophilia. And the examples of drugs that are involved in idiosyncratic delay are phenytoin, sulfonamides, valproate. Similarly, metabolic idiosyncrasy is seen in which there is production of toxic metabolites, like the case of isoniazid, ketoconazole, diclofenac. And the other kind is predictable, right? So here, this is dose related, and because this is something that normally you see with drug, and it is dose related. Dose related means when you give it at a therapeutic dose, you are not suspecting so much of hepatic injury, but then if you give it at a higher dose, then you predict that drug induced liver injury is something that can happen, right? So it happens with intrinsically hepatotoxic drugs and may be seen within hours. The intrinsic pattern, the injury pattern is usually necrosis. Clinically fulminant acute hepatitis can be seen. The example is acetaminophen. When given in high doses, it produces the reactive intermediate called an acetyl para-benzoquinonimine, and this reactive intermediate is known to cause hepatic injury. The clinical manifestations of DILI. The manifestations of drug-induced hepatotoxicity are highly variable. They range from asymptomatic elevation of liver enzymes to fulminant hepatic failure. The injury may suggest either hepatocellular injury or cholestatic injury. In case of hepatostatic injury, there is elevation of aminotransferase levels, and in case of cholestatic injury, there is elevated alkaline phosphatase levels. Now, going on to the pathological manifestations. Besides the clinical and lab data, the pattern of histology may be classified into different categories like acute or chronic hepatocellular injury, acute or chronic cholestasis, and granulomatous or autoimmune hepatitis, vascular lesions, veno-occlusive disease, and neoplastic lesions. Okay, here we've got different pathological manifestations, and then we have also linked the pathological manifestations with the drugs that cause those manifestations. It is not so important to go into such a detail, but then those of you who are interested, you can go into it. Okay, now coming to diagnosis of DILI. It is not such an easy thing to diagnose the DILI because the drug involved, if it is a single drug is involved, then the diagnosis may be relatively simple. But if there are multiple agents that are being used at the same time, then implicating one single agent may be difficult. And also it is difficult because the latency period is highly variable for hepatotoxicity by various agents. And it may be from 5 days to 90 days. So generally, the diagnosis of DILI is difficult with use of multiple agents. And DILI may be classified as hepatocellular, cholestatic, or mixed according to the pattern of elevation of the liver enzymes that are based on the lab test available. Okay. I don't know how many of you have looked into this case of diclofenac and the extreme toxicity in pulses. Diclofenac is something that we normally take for pain killing, right? It's an NSAID and it's widely used. You see different brands of diclofenac here in Nepal as well, Voviran, Ninja, there are different brands. It is relatively non-toxic to humans and we've been using it. But then the thing is, diclofenac was found to be very much toxic in pulses. How so? You're not feeding the diclofenac to the pulses, but what happened was that the diclofenac was very much used in veterinary medicine. And whenever the animals that will give diclofenac, if they died for different reason, then some of the animals, maybe they were dug, and then the carcass of the animal, it was dug, and then it was put underground, right? But then some of the carcass, they were left to rot outside itself. So the vultures that are the normal scavengers, they came and ate the carcass, and on eating that kind of carcass, there were vultures dying in very large numbers. So this brought forward the problem of the toxicity of diclofenac, and then what they did was they made it, they banned the use of diclofenac in animal purpose or veterinary use so that the vultures would not die of it. This is linked with species, or like the difference of drug with relation to species, right? We have talked about species variation on the effect of the drugs, right? So here, the diclofenac example of diclofenac in pulses specifies how different is the species variation of the effect of diclofenac. Diclofenac hepatotoxicity is typically associated with acute hepatitis, and necrosis is there, is seen. It usually causes focal necrosis and inflammation, but with severe cases, the injury may be confluent and submassive in humans. Okay, we just saw the example of diclofenac, which is an NSAID, right? So hepatic related side effects of NSAIDs has been reported to occur in 3% of patients receiving the drugs. So with NSAIDs, hepatotoxicity is relatively large, you can say. The mechanism by which almost all the NSAIDs, they produce hepatotoxicity, it is either immunologic or metabolic, and there may be dose-related toxicity as seen with aspirin and acetaminophen. With aspirin, there is also hypersensitive kind of reaction, but then with acetaminophen or paracetamol, it is almost always the dose-related one. Acetaminophen, it is almost entirely metabolized in the liver, and there are minor metabolites like N-acetyl parabenzoquinone imine, right, which is responsible for hepatotoxicity that is seen in overdoses of the drugs. The mechanism of acetaminophen hepatotoxicity includes depletion of hepatocyte glutathione. I said that glutathione is implicated in conjugation of the metabolite, right? So this leads to the accumulation of the toxic metabolite, resulting in mitochondrial dysfunction and alteration of innate immunity. The lowest dose of acetaminophen to cause hepatotoxicity is believed to be between 125 to 150 mg per kg. And the threshold dose to cause hepatotoxicity in adults is 10 to 15 gram of acetaminophen. NAC is considered the antidote of acetaminophen, or N-acetylcysteine. This is antidote of acetaminophen, and it should be given within 8 hours of acetaminophen poisoning. Now moving on to Reye syndrome. Reye syndrome is rare but serious condition that causes swelling in the liver and brain and results in severe damage in children that are recovering from viral infection. That is why aspirin is relatively contraindicated in children less than 12 years of age. This Reye syndrome is predominantly seen in children given acetyl salicylic acid or aspirin. Mitochondrial dysfunction is seen in the liver and some other organs, and it produces microvesicular steatosis or fat accumulation with severe liver dysfunction. Another agent that is implicated in drug-induced liver injury is alcoholic liver disease. Right? Alcohol, when taken in small doses or in small amounts, it does not cause so much hepatotoxicity. But following years of heavy drinking, there can be alcoholic liver disease. Right? Alcohol can cause inflammation in the liver. Over time, there can be scarring and cirrhosis as well. Right? Cirrhosis is often considered the final phase of alcoholic liver disease, and women are more predisposed to alcoholic liver disease because metabolism is slower in males. Let us look into the effect of alcohol in the liver. Basically, alcohol mobilizes the peripheral fat and increases the fat synthesis in the liver in dose-dependent manner. That's why in the case of alcoholic people, you can see fatty liver disease, right? The regular alcohol, it induces the microsomal enzymes, and chronic alcoholism, it subjects the liver to oxidative stress, causes cellular necrosis followed by fibrosis. In case of alcohol detoxification, alcohol first converts into acetaldehyde as a result of alcohol dehydrogenase action on it, and then the acetaldehyde dehydrogenase acts on acetaldehyde to make it non-toxic. But then if lots of alcohol is consumed, then acetaldehyde buildup is there, which causes hepatocyte damage and inflammation in chronic amounts when taken in large amounts for long period of time. Alcoholic cirrhosis, it leads to vitamin and nutritional deficiencies, like vitamin B1 and magnesium is often given in case of alcoholic cirrhosis. Now coming on to hepatotoxicity in TB patients. It is said that the risk of delay in case of active TB treatment studies, it ranges from 5 to 33%. So you can consider the level of hepatotoxicity that is seen in case of people who are taking antitubercular therapy, right? Because those on antitubercular therapy, they experience hepatotoxicity in 5 to 33% of the cases. That's relatively higher range, right? Because you are giving drugs like isoniazid, rifampicin, and pyrazinamide, and all of these are drugs are implicated in DILI. What happens is that there is accumulated hepatotoxic toxicity as a result of combination of the drugs. Right? normally if you give isoniazid only, it also causes hepatotoxicity, but then addition of rifampicin, it increases the risk. So does addition of pyrazinamide. Have a look at the various drugs, various factors that contribute to the susceptibility of the drugs. Okay, what we can see is that in case of female, halothane, nitrofurantoin, and salendac, they are known to cause hepatotoxicity. Similarly, in case of male, amoxicillin, clavulanate, this is known to cause hepatotoxicity. If a person is old, then acetaminophen, halothane, isoniazid, amoxicillin, clavulanate, they all can cause hepatotoxicity. Similarly, in case of young age, salicylates and valproic acid, they are linked with hepatotoxicity. In case of fasting or malnutrition, acetaminophen is linked with hepatotoxicity. So you can see that same acetaminophen, this is involved in hepatotoxicity if the person is old and if the person is fasting or if the person is malnourished, right? Similarly, halothane in old age and when there is large body mass index or obesity, then it is known to be hepatotoxic. So what happens is that the risk factors, they tend to add up, okay? So if you are giving a drug with a tracker, then you should especially be on a lookout if the person is obese, if the person has diabetic mellitus, and if the person consumes alcohol, and you should also look for chronic hepatitis. Similarly, if you are a person taking acetaminophen, should watch out. The person should not be fasting, should not be using isoniazid or alcohol at the same time, right? And also food is another factor. So there are different factors that are linked with ELI. You can have a look at this later on. Okay, I'm not sure how many of you have opened BNF, right? BNF stands for British National Formulary, and then this comes out every 6 months. So this is one of the most up-to-date book that provides information on drug and different things. Like you can have a look on hepatotoxicity if you go to appendix 2, right? So there are lots of things that are given in BNF. I'd recommend you guys to download it and have a look. Okay? This is one of the best books that I find that you can use as compared to SIMS and MIMS. This is a lot better in that it comes out every 6 months, and there's a big team that goes into the making of BNF. And BNF comes out under NHS. NHS stands for National Health Services in Britain, right? UK. So because NHS employs almost 500,000 people, so there are lots of people who are working in NHS, and there are lots of contributors in BNF as well. So this is one of the best books that you can go for when it comes to looking good information on drugs. Okay, hepatotoxicity in liver impairment. We just said that there are different drugs that cause that lead to hepatotoxicity, right? So if there is already liver impairment, then the chance of hepatotoxicity further increases. So the drugs that cause dose-related toxicity, they may be doing so in lower doses in case of hepatic impairment. And if the drug causes reaction of idiosyncratic kind, then the frequency increases more in case of liver impairment. So these drugs should be avoided or used very carefully in cases with liver disease. This is the long list given in DNF, right? So you can, for hepatotoxicity, either you can go to liver tox, or you can use BNF. Now, looking onto prevention of drug-related induced liver injury, you can see that resilience is most important, right? Identification of risk factors is important, as we discussed earlier. Then, ALT monitoring with certain drugs is important. Similarly, safer marketing strategies should be used, and most useful way to prevent delay would be to educate patients about the warning signs of the drug injury, like abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, jaundice. And they clinically, when you look at it, there is a poor correlation between the degree of ALT elevation and the severity of liver disease. And histology is more accurate indicator, but then you can't always take histological slides from a patient, right? So jaundice is a good predictor of mortality drug-induced hepatitis. In case of management, prompt discontinuation of the offending drug is generally required. Supportive and symptomatic therapies should be done, and there should be monitoring for the development of acute liver failure. In case of acute liver failure, liver transplantation can be the only therapeutic option. And like N-acetylcysteine can be useful in case of paracetamol poisoning and other cases as well. Okay. When it comes to the treatment, use of glucocorticoids for immune-mediated reactions or also deoxycholic acid for cholestatic liver injury. They remain controversial therapies, but they have been used. In the subset of DLI, there is a trend towards worse prognosis on steroid therapy. It may be reasonable to treat the case of prolonged cholestasis due to DLI with UDCA. And drug-induced hepatitis with allergic features with no improvement after drug withdrawal, a short course of steroids may be justifiable. Antioxidants have also been proposed as treatment modality for severe DLI like N-acetylcysteine, but then this is very good in case of paracetamol overdose, but then it may not be so much better in other cases. At the earliest sign of liver failure, prompt referral to liver transplant unit is indicated if the option is there. This chart is taken from Medscape, where it talks about the different injury patterns and the drugs that are linked with different injury patterns. Right. Hepatocellular pattern is there, cholestatic pattern is there, Dr. Penick syndrome, or the vanishing bile duct syndrome is there, nodular regeneration, hyperplasia, drug induced autoimmune hepatitis, all these things are there. Okay, in conclusion, the drug induced liver injury must be included as a differential diagnosis in all the patients with abnormal liver panel. The management of the patients with drug induced liver injury needs increased resilience as well. Once liver failure develops, spontaneous survival in the absence of liver transplantation is rare. So, one should be on the lookout for hepatotoxicity. Okay, thank you. That was all about hepatotoxicity.